thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here. Lord, thank you for this house. Lord, thank you that we get to come. We get to enjoy the pleasantries of church service tonight. And Lord, we just ask above everything else, God, that you would speak to us. Because God, we don't come to hear from a man. We don't come to hear from the old or from the young. We don't come for tradition. Lord, we come to hear from you. And we acknowledge that at the Rock, it's Jesus that's our leader. Lord, that we look to you. We don't look to the advice and the direction of a man or a woman. Lord, we look to you. And we ask in the name of Jesus that your Holy Spirit today would be our counselor, would lead us and teach us and guide us and direct us and remind us of your word that you've taught us today, Lord, that we would walk out of this place equipped and prepared and empowered to be who you've called us to be, your church. Lord, what an honor and a privilege it is to be in the house of God. And we don't take it for granted because we know that you have blessed us in this house. And God, all those blessings that you've given to us, we ask that you would bless all the other churches across the Inland Empire. It's so wonderful to hear about churches that are growing and that are booming in population for the name and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we are not threatened by that. We are not put down by that. But God, we thank you that our brothers and sisters that are out there in the Inland Empire are preaching and teaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we ask that you would bless them today. Churches like Harvest and Sandals. Lord, we thank you for churches like Water of Life as they open up a new campus this week. Lord, we thank you for churches like The Way. And God, for churches like Emmanuel Baptist and Crossroads and Abundant Life and New Creation, all sorts of different churches. Lord, we ask that you would bless them as you have blessed us. Speak to them, Holy Spirit, as we ask that you would speak to us. And God, tonight, as our nation remembers and our nation mourns for the terrorist acts in Paris, God, we ask that you would just be with your churches. God, we ask that you would anoint that country. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that thousands or hundreds of years ago, Lord, there was a country that stood against the radical movement of Islam in the Battle of Tours, and they stood their ground, and they halted the progression of Islam into the European continent. And Lord, I ask that you would bless them for the contribution that they have to the spread of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And God, I ask that you would be with each one of those families, Lord, the families of those victims, and Lord, comfort them. Lord, we thank you, God, that good would triumph over evil. In Jesus' mighty name, we thank you for this house. We thank you for your people all across the world. We ask that you would speak to them as you speak to us today. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
amen.
Amen. Many of you didn't know that in around 700 AD that there was a great battle that happened in Paris, or not in Paris, in Tours, France, where the radical spread of Islam was coming across Italy and across the southern part of Europe. And the French, of all people, we always know from World War I and World War II, we don't think that the French are very active in battle, but the French were the ones that took a stand and literally in a period of a day and two halted the entire progression of Islam across the entire continent of Europe. If it wasn't for the Battle of Tours, who knows where Europe would have been. But thank God somebody took a stand against evil. And I'll tell you what, the devil hasn't forgotten, and that's why we need to pray for our brothers and sisters, because the people that stand for Jesus Christ, the devil's got a big target on their back. And I'll tell you what, we're going to pray for our brothers and sisters. Amen?
Amen?
So keep them in your prayers. Well, today, I want to talk to you. I want to ask you a question. Before we say the title, before we do any of that, I just want to ask you a question. You can be honest with me, all right? Because this is a real question, a real honest question. Have you ever, in a moment of frustration, anxiety, stress, pressure, frustration, or anger, whatever it might be, one of those negative emotions, have you ever just lost it? Have you ever blown it? I mean, just like really blown it. Can anybody say, Pastor Luke, amen, I've done that. Now, if you say, you know what, I haven't done that, okay. Today, you need to pay attention because the moment will come, and if you listen to the notes, that don't have to happen. Have you ever, let me ask you another question, have you ever sat down there, and I've been there, so have you ever sat down there and just heard the pastor or the teacher or the speaker preach, and you look at them and the way that they speak, and you can just see that it emanates from them, and you just say, man, I want to get my life together like they have it. Has anybody ever been there? Man, that's me. Amen. One of these days, I want to get my life together like these guys on the stage. You see, we all make mistakes. We all lose it from time to time. I want to tell you a little story about me because I'm working on it. Thank God we're all on this journey together. Amen. Amen. Don't judge me. Only God can. No, I'm just kidding. Last week, now normally you kind of wait till things aren't fresh, but last week, I was going through some things, I was thinking about some things, and last week on Tuesday, I was on my way out with a couple of the pastors here at the church to a conference down in Indio, and as I was leaving in Indio, I was supposed to meet everybody at a park and ride. They were all there waiting for me, and last week, I lost my keys. Oh, my Lord, I cannot stand it when I lose my keys. Anybody ever lost a keys? And somebody, you got to get to work, you got to go somewhere, you need to get out the door, and your keys are nowhere to be found. And I know where my spare keys are, hallelujah. They're in my desk, here, in the office. So I lost my keys, and I'm going around the house, and I'm just making a mess, tearing everything up, and my wife and my kids, they're in bed because it was early in the morning, and I'm just on a rampage looking for my keys. And finally, I go upstairs, and I'm like, Stacy, I lost my keys. And you need to help me find them, because I've come to grips, I've come to realization that as a man, I am incapable of finding anything in my house. And I fully acknowledge that she is so much better at finding things than I am, and thank God that she has been graced and gifted with that. So I place the burden upon her. So there she was looking for my keys, and I'm looking for my keys, and I text the people, the pastors that I was going to meet, and I says, listen, you guys just got to go without me because I don't have keys. And Stacy's like, just take my van, and the kids and I will just stay at home trapped all day long, no big deal. You just take the van. I'm like, no, I'm not taking the van. I want the principle of the matter. It's my keys. And so there I am. I'm getting frustrated. I'm getting mad. You know, the house was a lot dirtier than it should be, and that's my fault too. And so there I was losing it. And every moment that goes by, I was like that steam kettle that was just steaming out of the top. I mean, literally, it's like you could see steam coming out of my ears. There, I'm texting one of the pastors, hey, just go without me. I don't even know if I'm going to go today. And my phone froze. So what did I do? Because I'm a man of God, I threw my phone on the ground. Because it's like my precious. Thank God I know myself a little bit better and I have one of those like impact proof cases, because the moment I threw it on the ground, I ran after it like, oh, I'm so sorry, my baby. So there I am, I'm blaming Stacy, I'm blaming the kids, I'm saying all sorts of mean and terrible things. And my wife, who loves me so much, who respects me so much, she says, you know what, why don't you just stay down in Indio tonight? You don't even need to come home. You're going to be like that. Sure enough, I walk out of the door and I say, you know what, I might as well stay down there. And I left. Yeah, you know, we all lose it from time to time. Amen. It's funny, though. You know, it's like as soon as I got in the car and as soon as I was driving away, the Holy Spirit wouldn't let me get away with that. And I had to call her. I think she was mad at me, so she didn't pick up the phone. So I had to call her and I had to leave a message. Baby, I love you. I'm so sorry. Can you forgive me? I was wrong. You were right. I was bad. You were good. She didn't text me all day long. I kept texting her like, baby, did you get my message? Are you ignoring me? Do you forgive me? Can I come home? And she's like, silent treatment all day long. Looking back at it, it's almost like somebody else came out. As a matter of fact, somebody else did come out. The dead me surfaced. Do you know what I mean by when I say the dead me? You probably know, because when I asked you if you've ever freaked out, you were probably thinking the same thing. It was like, that's not me. That's the dead me. Because Paul the Apostle said, I'm dead. My flesh has died to Christ. But all of a sudden, somehow that dead me got resurrected in that moment. And I was kind of looking outside of myself like, who are you? You see, oftentimes what happens, we can deal with a little bit of inconsistency. Can we be real? We can be a little bit inconsistent. And, you know, God doesn't want us to be inconsistent. God wants us to be consistent. God wants us to continually imitate the apostles, imitate Jesus Christ, and become like him. Why? Because, you know, ultimately, as we've learned throughout the course of this, of the changing generations, and through what we've seen, is people are less interested in the words we speak as so much as the actions that we take and the actions that we have. And if we can't be consistent in our lives, if it seems like whenever pressure, whenever stress, whenever anxiety, whenever arguments, whenever, you know, somebody pokes at you or prods at you in your relationship on the job or your kids or whatever it might be, and it seems like whenever we crack under those things, it seems like we almost ruin our witness sometimes with people. But God wants us to be consistent. As a matter of fact, we all know that the Bible tells us that we are new creations. So I know that when I look back on that situation, oh, so long ago, 5 days ago, amen, God's still working on me. We're all on a journey together. Amen. When that flesh arises, we kind of look at ourselves and say, you know what? I know that the Bible tells me that I'm a new creation. I know that the old has passed away, and behold, all things have become new. I know that I have crucified my flesh, and the life that I live, I now live unto Jesus Christ. I know that. But it seems like sometimes I don't get that. That there's this inconsistency, and it's a hard struggle. Can I just say it? The struggle is real. Amen. Can I get a witness? Anybody else ever feel that way? Oh, man, I'm so glad that I'm not preaching to myself. Hallelujah. Thank God. The struggle's real. That we find ourselves continually battling with this nature, with this old self that's supposedly dead according to the Word of God. But thank God that the Bible gives us some light. It sheds some light on the topic. Today I want to talk to you about being bound to Jesus. Being bound to Jesus. And I want to show you some things out of the Word of God. I want to show you something that I think that we easily skip over or that we don't quite comprehend as clear. We don't hear it as much as maybe we ought to hear, because it's a hard concept to talk about. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Romans. Romans in the 6th chapter. I want to talk to you about Romans, or what Paul the Apostle was talking about. Now, Romans is an amazing section of Scripture. I mean, Paul just lays it down. I love Romans, the 5th chapter, Romans, the 6th chapter. We're going to talk about this predisposition or this nature that we have. Romans in the 7th chapter, Paul the Apostle talks about, man, oh, what a wretched man that I am. Who will save me? Who will rescue me? Because I do the things that I don't want to do, and the things that I do want to do, I don't do. And I find that there's this war between my flesh and my spirit. And then I love how Romans chapter 8 comes back and encourages and says, there is therefore no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Amen. But in Romans, the 6th chapter, Paul the Apostle begins to tell us a really unique and a really interesting statement. It's almost kind of hard to understand. As a matter of fact, he comes and clarifies that. And I want to read to you in the New Living Translation. Now, you've got, most likely, if you're at the Rock, you've got a New King James Version. And that's great. The message is exactly the same. The words are just a little bit different. But Paul the Apostle, in Romans, in the 6th chapter, look what he says in Romans, the 6th chapter. He says, thank God. Amen. That's good right there. We just close it down right there. Thank God. No, he goes even further. He says, thank God you were once slaves of sin. We get that. We were in bondage. We were bound. No matter what we did, no matter how hard we try. Have you ever experienced that without Jesus? Self-help messages don't work. Like, we can try to be a level of good, but we will never be the level of good that God created us to be, because we cannot do that without the sin nature being removed from us. So Paul says, thank God you were once slaves to sin, but now you wholeheartedly obey this teaching we have given you. That's great. Paul says, man, I have taught you. You were once a slave. You're changing. Your life is different. Things are going good for you. But look what he says in verse number 18. He says, now you are free from the slavery to sin. You have become slaves to righteous living. See, this is where I think we begin to miss it a little bit. We look at sin and the sin nature and we say, amen, free at last. Free at last, right? Thank God Almighty. Anybody know Dr. Martin Luther King's speech? I'm free at last. I no longer am a slave to sin. I love that Bethel song. It was a really cool song. I am no longer a slave to sin. I'm free. But see what he says? He says, you didn't become free to nothing. He says, you are now no longer slaves to sin. Now you are slaves to righteous living. Oh, wait a minute. That's a little bit hard. Because Pastor Luke, I want to be free. I want to be me. I don't want to have any bondages. I don't want to be bound. I don't want to be connected. I don't want to be chained to or held to anything. I want to be free like a bird, free like an eagle. Amen? But he says, you're slaves. You were a slave to sin, but then you got bought. That's slavery term, right? Purchased. Keith Hershey was here a couple of weeks ago talking about that God literally purchased you. Redeemed you, swiped the credit card of Jesus Christ through his blood on the cross, purchased you and I. So now all of a sudden our freedom doesn't come from a releasement, but now we're no longer slaves to sin, we're slaves to righteous living. And that's a hard idea to grasp a hold of. So Paul says this in verse number 19, he says these words, he says, because of the weakness of your human nature, I love that. That was like a total amen, amen, Paul, thank you for realizing and recognizing that I got problems. Paul's saying, because you can't handle it the real way, I'm going to explain to you the illustration of slavery to help you understand all this. Paul says, this is an illustration. I'm going to paint a picture for you. I'm going to draw it out. I'm going to try to make it as clear as I can in terms that you can understand slavery. Now, we understand slavery. Why? Well, not because of what happened in the United States hundreds of years ago, but we see it. The new thing, the new hot thing is human trafficking, that this underground slavery has been brought to the surface, and now we are aware that there are people all over the world that are being caught and kidnapped and brought into and taken into a position of slavery. And this doesn't just happen around the world. This happens right here at home in the Inland Empire. Human trafficking is a real problem. We understand slavery. So Paul says, listen, I'm gonna use the words, I'm gonna use an illustration, I'm gonna give you a speech, a talk in which you can understand, and I'm talking about the subject of slavery. So he goes on and he says, previously, you let yourselves be slaves to impurity and lawlessness. Go on to the next part, which led even deeper to sin. Amen? You were there. It's like no matter how hard you tried, you could not stop but to get worse and worse and worse. It's like, have you ever told a lie and then you got to tell a lie to cover up the lie, and then you got to tell a lie to cover up the lie that you told to cover up the lie, and then you got to tell, you know what I'm saying? It led deeper and deeper and deeper into sin. But look what he says. He says, now you must give yourselves. Oh, listen. This is where we miss it. He says, now you must give yourselves to be slaves to righteousness, righteous living, so that you will become holy. That's a voluntary action. Paul says Jesus Christ died on the cross to free you from the bondages of sin and the bondages of death and the nature, the DNA that was on the inside of you. In that DNA code somewhere, scientists can't find it because they're not looking for it. There is a nature. It's called sin. And no matter what we do, we can't get rid of that. But the only thing that cancels that out is the blood of Jesus Christ. So Jesus came and he freed us to be slaves from sin. But he says, now you must choose to give yourselves to be slaves to righteous living, that you will become holy. Look what he says in verse number 20. When you were slaves to sin, you were free from the obligation to do right. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Before I knew about Jesus, drinking was no big deal. Drugs, no big deal. Cussing and lewd activity and sexual promiscuity and the entertainment of the eyes and the lust of the flesh. Man, that's just how I was because I was born that way. Amen. He says, you had no obligation. You didn't know. But verse number 21 comes and he tells us, and what was the result? You're now ashamed of the things you used to do. Things that end in eternal doom. Today, Pastor Mondo and I were out at water baptism this morning, and we were baptizing, and Pastor Mondo told me a story. He says, you know, there was a guy, I remember he came, and he was just like, listen, will you hold me down under the water for every 1 second for every commandment of God that I've broken? You know, he was ashamed. He had guilt. He had condemnation on his shoulders, on his heart, on his spirit because of the things that he had done. And Pastor Mondo says, listen, man, God's not holding that against you. You've got Jesus. It doesn't matter. The whole like self-mutilation thing, it doesn't work. You've got Jesus. He wants you as you are. So he says, you're ashamed of what you've done. You look back at your past, you say, man, I've messed up. But I love what he says. He goes on and he says, but now you're free. Listen to this. Now you're free from the power of sin and have become slaves. There it is again. To God. But now you do the things that lead to holiness and eternal life. In verse number 23, we know this. He says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. You see, you and I, we were slaves to sin. We were held in bondage to our nature. We had a predisposition. You understand what that means? That means we defaulted to that category. We defaulted to that action. We defaulted to those thoughts. We defaulted to those tendencies of sin nature. But it says it no longer has a power over you because of Jesus. We're free. And the reason I wanted to talk to you about this today is that, remember that word I used, inconsistency? Sometimes I get a little irritated. I get a little tired that I can get inconsistent because I don't want to be an inconsistent Christian. I want to be a consistent Christian. I want to be the same. I want to be like Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I want to be just like that. I want to be consistent. I want to keep going. I don't want to have to like look back and be like, man, that was somebody else. That was the dead me. And how is that dead me still showing up? Because I thought he was dead. So we have this problem. And today I want to talk to you about that. Paul says that you're slaves and you're slaves. And I thought, you know, I'm a visual guy. I like visual things. Maybe it's because I grew up watching TV. I don't know. I'm a visual person, so I got a little visual illustration. Can we go like visual? All right. Can we have some time? Some of you are like, all right. So I need some volunteers. So Pastor Dan, can I borrow you? Pastor Joel, yeah, man, can I borrow you? He's like, oh no, I'm only borrowing you two because I know you guys, and I know that you won't hold it against me later on. Now I just want to say you can come closer. Now I just want to tell both of you. This has nothing to do with my assumption of your character. This is for illustrative purposes only. Are we clear on that? We good? Amen? Do I need to have you sign a release sign? Okay, stay right there. Now I want to give you an illustration of what we are, of who we are, and what happens to us. Now I got, you know, me and my props, man. I'll tell you. I raided the children's ministry. Hallelujah. I got some things for you and me. All right, so Pastor Joel. Remember, I said this has nothing to do with your character, but you are sin nature. Pastor Dan, since you preached so good this morning, I'm coming to a godly conclusion. You are righteous nature. Okay, now, Pastor Joel, I need you to come over here and just stand in that corner. Pastor Dan, would you just go and stand over there in that corner? Now, the Bible tells us that we are slaves in bondage. We are bound to the nature. So I am going to bind myself. Now these are children's ministry handcuffs, so I don't even know if they're going to fit. But not you, Pastor Joel. Let me have that. Oh man, that's a nice watch, man. All right. There we go. This is us. We were born this way. No matter what I want to do, now I don't want to hurt our wrist and I don't want to hurt his wrist, but no matter what I do, if I try to walk, just stay there. I can't. I'm bound. I'm stuck. Paul the Apostle says that you keep doing things in your sin nature, and it keeps leading to worse and worse and worse and worse character. And that we are stuck, we are bound. I can't get out of this. I don't have the key. But the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ came and he freed us from sin. And he freed us from death. Now thank God these are trick handcuffs, so I don't need the key. Amen. Now I'm free from sin nature. Amen. Yeah, you can clap, Elijah. That's good, man. Amen. Hallelujah. And this is where I want to live. Get it? This is where I want to live. Now you say, no. But this is in reality where a lot of us live. I don't have that anymore. But do you know there's something entwined in us? It's called a predisposition. It's a tendency, a default nature. Tuesday, here was my problem with Tuesday. I was living right here. I'm free. I'm free like an eagle. I got nothing. I got no chains. I got no ties. I got nothing holding me back except a disposition of sin. So when stress comes my way, when anxiety comes my way, when pressure and anger and frustration and relationship problems come my way, my predisposition is like gravity. And it pulls me. And it pulls me. And it pulls me. And it pulls me until all of a sudden, even though I'm free, I'm hanging out.
Right.
We're buddies. But you see, the Bible says, no. Just because you're free from sin doesn't mean that you get to hang out in no man's land. Now you have the choice, because you remember how Paul said it was a decision. We get to surrender. We get to give ourselves as slaves and servants to God. So here I am. In my predisposition, I want to hang out in no man's land. But you see, Paul says, no. You've got a decision to make. And you got to come over here and say, you know what? I was bought with a price. Look at you already knowing where we're going.
That's because I'm righteous.
He's righteous. He already knew that. The beginning and the end, the Alpha and the Omega, right? And I will willingly surrender myself to the righteous nature of Jesus Christ. That I will, like I said, like the Bible says, I know that I have died, but until I shackle myself, I will always, through predisposition, want to go. So then what happens? What happens to us is frustration comes, anxiety comes, Relationships poke at us. I don't think I can do this. I don't think I can make this. You don't understand. Nobody knows the trouble I've been. And gravity starts to pull us because I got a predisposition. But guess what happens? Oh, wait a minute. I can't. Because I am a slave, shackled, bound to righteousness. Thank you, Pastor Dan. Hold that sign. Thank you, Pastor Joel. You can hold that sign too. You can go back down. You can sit down for a moment. Thank you, guys. Keep on that sign. I'm gonna call you back. Hold on. All right, hold on. So you see, we have a predisposition. We have a default characteristic on our DNA to always want to go back to that sin nature. And exactly the result, the reason of that inconsistency that we live in is the fact that we want to, through our flesh, we want to live in no man's land, shackled to nobody. I don't want to answer to anybody. I want to be free, but I don't want to be bound over here, and I don't want to be committed because I have a fear of commitment. But God says, no. You were bought with a price, and I freed you from that. But you see, freedom from bondage is it binds us to righteousness. Freedom from bondage. I am separated from over here. But that doesn't mean that I get to live in no man's land. Why? Because freedom from bondage of sin and death and nature now binds me, connects me, captures me to righteousness. Because if I live in no man's land through the very essence of gravity, I will always, through predisposition, go back to my nature. But when I am held captive, Jesus, the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ took captivity captive. He didn't let y'all go. He took you, and he took you up to heaven. So you see, we have got to remain bound. So freedom from bondage binds us to righteousness. Now, that's why the reason I say that this was kind of a tough message is because nobody wants to hear that you're still a slave. That's a hard idea. That's a hard concept. I thought I was free. I thought I was a son and a daughter and an heir and a co-heir with Jesus. Yes, you are, but you are still a slave. Because Jesus, the Bible tells us that Jesus didn't see himself equal with God, didn't consider it robbery to make himself a slave himself. So you see, we have the same position through the eyes of God, and we have to be bound to righteousness because of a predisposition. So what happens is we have this freedom, and this freedom, we begin to take it, we begin to use buzzwords. You know what I'm talking about with buzzwords? Hot words. Words like grace. Words like forgiveness. Words like charity, words like religion, and we begin to use these words and we say, you know what, it's okay. I can do this because I have grace. I can do this because I can repent. I can do this because I have. And we want to live in this liberty that we have without being shackled to anything. But you see, the Bible tells us that was Paul's writing. Peter says these words in 1 Peter chapter 2. Peter says, this is the will of God, church, for you and I, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance a foolish man. That's great right there. Amen. That'll preach. Hallelujah. But what is he talking about? Look what he says. As free, you're free. You've been freed. You're here in no man's land. He says, as free, yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice. Just because you've been free doesn't mean that you get to hang out in the middle ground. He says, no, you've been freed, which means now it binds you to righteousness. Why? Because you are bond servants, slaves of God. Amen. So what happens? The inconsistency comes from the lack of our surrender to becoming a servant of God. So that's the problem. That's the problem. So what do we do? I mean, Pastor Luke, I have fed my sin nature all of my life. I remember Pastor Jim when he taught a message about the war between the spirit and the flesh. He used the example of two dogs. The dog of my flesh and the dog of my spirit. And whichever dog you feed will get bigger. Pastor Luke, I have a really big dog right now in my sin nature. And I got saved, but you know what? I still have some problems, and I got a chihuahua. over here. Now, my redeemed person may not be very big right now, but I got a lot of spunk. But you say, you know what, Pastor Luke, I've fed my life. I've fed my sin. I have fed my flesh. I have fed my thoughts. I have fed my lusts. I have fed my ideals. I have fed my dreams. I have fed myself. The entire course of my life, how can I not go back? That's predisposition. Sin brings us a predisposed nature, defaults to that. Thus our problem. The answer is simple, but yet so complex. The answer is in the title of the message. Stay bound to Jesus. But I really want to emphasize the first word in that point. Stay. Stay bound to Jesus. Because you see, Paul gave the illustration, we surrender ourselves. You are in control. You see, you have the keys to the handcuffs. You are in control of your disposition, of your nature, of your life. And we have the choice to say, you know what? In this moment of anxiety, in this moment of trouble, in this moment of tribulation, in this moment of frustration, I can't handle it. I don't want to deal with turning the other cheek right now. And I'm going to take the handcuff off and I'm going to go over here because I feel a whole lot better doing this. And then all of a sudden I do this and then I feel really bad. And so what do? I run over here. I say, I'm my life is yours. I'll never do it again. And then it happens again, right? We unshackle ourselves and we shackle ourselves. You see, the whole idea is for us to stay bound, connected, chained, handcuffed to Jesus. Talked about whatever dog you feed will be the biggest. Can I tell you something? Starving dogs make a lot of noise. I have two dogs. One of my dogs just had puppies. One of my dogs' predisposition from the moment we got her, she loved to eat. Oh my goodness, she's like 20 pounds overweight. She's a big roll. The other dog that just had puppies, because she has 8 or 7 little puppies feeding off her all the time, no matter what she does, she can't keep on weight. She's starving. And because she's starving, she makes a whole big racket. If you leave anything that's edible out anywhere in the house, I have literally seen her on my countertop. Because no matter what, she's trying to feed herself. She's starving. And a starving dog will make a lot of noise. And so what's happened is you've been feeding that dog of your flesh, that predisposition, that sin nature. You've been feeding it all your life. And now all of a sudden it's getting a little upset because it's starting to starve. Because you got Jesus. And you're feeding the flesh, or you're feeding the spirit. But a starving dog's gonna make a lot of noise. But let me tell you something, just because it makes a lot of noise, listen, your flesh is going to raise hell to go back to its predisposition. But that's why we choose to stay bound to Jesus. Because that dog, that flesh, that might make a lot of noise, it might rattle my cage, but as long as I'm connected to Jesus, I don't go back to the person that I once was. In John the 8th chapter, Jesus says these words. John chapter 8, you can go there with me if you want. John chapter 8, in your Bibles, Jesus has this amazing, like, debate kind of argument with his Jewish followers. John chapter 8, verse number 31, Jesus says to the Jews who believed him, if, that's the biggest little word in the Bible right there. If, he says, if you abide in my word. I want you to pay attention to that word abide, okay? Abide. If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. That's great. Verse number 32. And you shall, you know this verse. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. That's a great verse, man. I'm freedom. I'm no longer a slave. Now look what the rebuttal comes to verse number 33. The scribes and the Pharisees and those who are around them, they answered and said, we are Abraham's descendants, and yet we have never been in bondage to anyone. So how can you say, I will be made free? They're saying, Jesus, I've never been a slave to anybody. So what are you talking about? That's what they're saying, okay? That's the San Bernardino language. Verse number 34. Jesus said, most assuredly I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave of sin. Predisposition. We were born with the nature of sin. Nobody had to teach you how to lie, but we did it. So he says, you're already a slave to sin. They were looking at the physical world. Jesus says, no, I'm talking about your spiritual condition. I'm talking about your heart. Verse number 35. He says, a slave does not abide. Remember, I said pay attention to that word abide. He says, a slave does not abide in the house forever, but a son abides forever. Verse number 36. Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. I like that. I want to focus on that. Amen. See, the word abide, the first time Jesus used it is a tense. We have tenses when we speak. Like I can say, I love my wife and I love pizza. But you understand that that love is a very different love, hopefully, right? Like my love for pizza and my love for my wife are two different loves. And so here's a tense, abide. First there, the first abide uses in verse number 31 is connected. If you stay connected, Pastor Dan, can I borrow you again? If you stay connected, you will be one of my disciples. My word will influence your life. Now he goes on and he says, when he talks again, he says about that abide, he says, now a slave does not abide. Now that is live. That's a different tense. He's saying that slave doesn't live in the house forever. Why? Slaves get sold. They go home. They go to their own house. He says, but a son stays. You're always a part of the family. When you're a slave, you got a different last name. You got a different pretense. You got a whole different history. But when you're a son, you're part of the family. Your blood is different. You see, blood is thicker than water. And Jesus says, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So Jesus says, you are no longer that slave to the sin nature. But if you, that first abide says, stay connected. There it is. Stay bound to Jesus. He says, you will be free. You will be free. Pastor Dan, thank you. I might call you up one more time. All right? It's getting your exercise. You're tired after today anyways. So he says, you'll be free. So you see, the answer there is to stay connected to Jesus, to stay bound to Jesus. But the question goes, how do I stay connected to Jesus? I really want to. I want to stay connected, Pastor Luke, but I just sometimes I struggle with that. Why? Because you're listening to the starving dog. You're listening to the starving dog. The starving dog's going to make a whole racket in your life, and you've got to learn to shut that out and stay connected to Jesus, to stay bound to Jesus. So how do we stay bound to Jesus? Well, staying connected, getting rid of this inconsistency has everything to do with proximity. Proximity. Why? Because proximity defines or determines disposition. Now, we had a predisposition, which means it was a default. Predisposition means when something happens, I'm going to go that way. But proximity determines disposition. Have you ever been afraid? Any of the ladies in here? It's dark in the house. I don't want to go down there. But then your husband or your friend or a family member comes and you stay next to them. You feel a little bit better, don't you? I remember we went camping one time. My wife and I, we went camping up in Yosemite. It was really cold that night. And, you know, I didn't want to sleep with all her, it was all her family. And then we went camping. So I didn't want to sleep with her family. I wanted to sleep with my wife. So we got our own little pup tent. Everybody else was in a big old tent. Sure enough, about 3 minutes after we set up our tent and fell asleep, a bear touched my wife's head through the tent, like sniffed her nose. She could hear it walking around. Right away, her disposition went to this, shaking. Freaked out. Well, now, despite how you feel about gun control laws or not, on the other tent was her brother. Now, I didn't know he had one, but all of a sudden he's snoring and he hears her talking about it and he goes, what? What's going on? Dude, you brought a gun to a national park? That's like a felony. But you know what happened? We ended up going to that tent. And we all ended up dogpiling on each other for the next 3 days. Why? Because proximity determines disposition. In the tent, away and separated from everybody else, fear would have been my disposition. But when we were dogpiled with my brother and his gun, not Pastor Dan, my other brother-in-law, the proximity to that perceived safety determined our disposition. All of a sudden, I wasn't afraid anymore because I knew if that bear was going to come, That bear was going to have a hard time. It's exactly the same thing. Proximity determines your disposition. The closer you are to Jesus determines your disposition. Which means when frustration and anxiety and stress and pressure come their way, the closer you are to Jesus, the more you are like him, and you don't react how you once used to, and that gravity effect of your predisposition is changed because proximity determines your disposition. But the problem is, too many of us, and I am included, too many of us determine our connection with Jesus based on our church attendance. You see, your connection to Jesus Christ should not be based on your church attendance. Can I preach? You're like, wait a minute, Pastor Luke, I don't understand. Which means what I'm saying is every time you are connected to Jesus should not be when you walk through and sit down on a chair in a church service. Your connection to Jesus should be every moment, every day of your life. But what happens is we get connected to Jesus once a week, once a month, once a year. Pastor Dan, can I borrow you one more time? Last time, I promise. And so what happens to us is we think we're connected, but our proximity determines our connection. Now these, Pastor Dan, we gotta be careful because these are like the chintziest handcuffs in the history of the world, all right? Proximity determines. And so here, you know what I say? I'm gonna come to church and I'm gonna be like Jesus and I'm gonna get the word of Jesus and here I am, I'm handcuffed. But then you know what? I don't wanna come to church for a week or two. Pastor Joel, come on. All right, come on. You know what? I got things going on in my life. Kids got soccer. Work's keeping me late. Oh, man, my relationships. Oh, you don't even understand what's going on. Oh, my God. And all of a sudden, we're connected. I'm connected to Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. But gravity takes me back to where I am because proximity determines your disposition. Thanks, guys. That's it. I promise. That's it. Thank you, Pastor Dan, and your righteous nature. Amen. Proximity determines our disposition. And see, our disposition, our connection to Jesus cannot just be based on once a week church attendance. Because what you do with Jesus on your own turf is when the rubber really hits the road. And so going back to Tuesday, my problem was I had been reading, but it wasn't the word. I had been praying, but it wasn't God's will, it was mine. And so what happened is my connection was based on somebody's clever and crafty book, and I swear I just preached upon that like 2 months ago, and my connection got a little bit further. And then all of a sudden, frustration hit, and my predisposition kicked in. Why? Because my proximity determines my disposition. So it's so important for you and I to stay connected to Jesus. I know it's Christianity 101. But you see, sometimes we need to realize that we have the choice to shackle ourselves, to bind ourselves to Jesus Christ. Or we have the choice, we have the decision, we have the option to let go and go back. But when we decide, you know what? I'm going to read my Bible today. When we decide, you know what? I just don't need to immerse myself in that culture anymore. It's not even a big deal. I don't need to go out with those people. I don't need to hear those words. Everybody's gossiping. Everybody's doing this. I'm going to come over here. And we decide to shackle ourselves to Jesus every day. The Bible says to pray without ceasing and everything. Give thanks to Jesus, to give thanks to God. When we decide to shackle ourselves to Jesus Christ, our proximity determines our disposition. And now all of a sudden, instead of going back to our predisposition, now we come to our new disposition, that new creation in Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus again says this statement in John the 15th chapter, verse number 5. He's talking to his disciples and Jesus says his words. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. That's a great illustration. And look what he says. He who abides in me and I in him abides. There it is. You know the tense of that abides is? Stays connected. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. It's awesome. For without me, you can do nothing. Amen. Predisposition. You see, Jesus is the vine. We're the branch, but we're the only branch in the history of nature that has the option to connect and to disconnect. I can break myself off of the vine and go back to my predisposition if I want. But Jesus says, if you abide, connect, stay, live, and dwell in me, stay connected, stay bound to Jesus, your proximity determines your disposition, and all of a sudden you'll begin to act and respond like Jesus would have and not like you would have. See, that was the lesson for me, is man, I let myself slide. Church, we let ourselves slide, even though this is Christianity 101. If I've seen it once, I've seen it 100 times. We get comfortable. Man, I endured the storm. I made it through. I overcame that temptation, and I got comfortable. And because I got comfortable, I let off for a day. I let off for a week. I let off for a month. And unknowing, gravity is taking its toll. And I still feel the shackle on my wrist, but gravity is taking its toll. And I find myself in predisposition. Because we have to remain, to stay bound to Jesus Christ. Church, you see, you're not bound for sin anymore. You're not bound to sin anymore. You're bound for glory. You are bound for glory. Now, that's a total play on words. I think I have that on the overheads. You are bound for glory. Why? You are bound for it, which means you are connected and held on to it, but you are also destined for it. Bound for glory. You're headed towards glory. Why? Because you are connected to Jesus Christ. But we have to make the conscientious decision, like Paul the Apostle said, which dog am I going to feed? My flesh is going to rattle my cage. It's going to raise hell, but I'm going to choose to feed my flesh. I'm going to choose, despite how my flesh feels right now. I lost my keys and I'm mad at my wife. To act like Jesus would and say, it's not your fault because I put them under the blanket where they were. Because proximity determines our disposition. And God's desire, God's will, remember what Peter said, God's will is that you and I would bump the ignorance of the world by not using the freedom that we've been given as a vice, but rather because we are slaves to Jesus Christ. I call it the 1-1 principle. The 1-1 principle. You ready for it? You want to know what the 1-1 principle is? Yeah. The 1-1 principle. Romans chapter 1, verse number 1. Paul the Apostle says, I am a bondservant, a slave to Jesus Christ. Philippians chapter 1, verse number 1. Paul and Timothy, bondservants, slaves to Jesus Christ. James. Oh, no, Titus 1:1. Sorry, guys. Titus 1:1. Paul, a bondservant, slave to Jesus. James 1:1. Different guy. James, a bondservant of God, slave. 2 Peter 1:1. Peter, a bondservant. You see, these men changed the world, not because of inconsistency, but because they realized that I have got to stay connected to Jesus Christ. Because even though I have been given freedom, a servant is not concerned with what his master will do for him. Uh-oh. God, I need you to do this and this and this and this, and then I'll love you. No, a servant is concerned on what he can do for his master. That is you and I. So we are no longer bound to sin. Now we are bound for glory. Why? Because our life, like Peter, like Paul, like James, with the understanding of, I don't want to be an inconsistent Christian anymore. I want to be a slave to Jesus Christ. So that way I can show the world what it really means to live. Because I no longer have a predisposition that pulls me back to what I once was. Now, because of my proximity, I act, I look, I live, and I speak like Jesus. Jesus Christ. And that is the kind of Christianity that will change this world. That is the kind of discipleship that Jesus says, all the world will know that you are my disciples. What if you keep my commandments and love one another? Stay bound to Jesus. Stay bound to Jesus. Well, Pastor Luke, I want to. How to? It's a priority thing. I can set priority. I can stay up late at night to watch that TV show that I had on my DVR when the kids fell asleep, and now it's time for us to watch grown-up TV. I can make a priority. I can make a priority to take an hour of my work day to go eat lunch. I can take a priority to take a shower in the morning. But will I make a priority in my life to stay bound to Jesus? Because your proximity determines your disposition. And church, God's will for your disposition is righteous nature. That is what he created us for. Righteous nature. To not look like the world, but to look like Jesus. And it will only come when we are bound to Jesus. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Amen. Some of you in this place, you're not bound. Some of you in this place, you are bound, and you haven't yet been freed. The Bible tells us that it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. Many of you in this place, maybe you're here tonight and you're wondering, you know what, I came into this church looking for answers. There are things going on in my life that I just don't understand. There are things going on that seem like they're beyond my control, and no matter what I do, it seems like I can't find the answer. It's just exactly what Paul said. That scripture probably spoke right to you. No matter how hard I try, it gets worse and worse and worse. Because you see, like Jesus said, without him, we can do nothing. And today I want to give you the opportunity in just the next couple of minutes to get connected to Jesus. You see, it can happen just that fast. Boom. In an instant, you have been freed from sin and now connected to Jesus. But it comes by making a decision. You see, being freed from sin and being freed from this predisposition that you and I once had doesn't come because I think so. It doesn't come because I hope so. It doesn't come because I go to church. You saw that with the big rope. It only comes because I'm connected to Jesus, because I was bought with a price. And like Paul the Apostle said in Romans, the 6th chapter, that I accepted the gift of God, eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. You see, the price was already paid for you and I, for our sin and for our shame 2,000 years ago on the cross of Calvary. Jesus died for your sin and your shame. He died for my sin and my shame. And now it's time for you and I to accept the gift, to realize that I no longer have to be this guy. I no longer have to be that person. I no longer have to be the person that doesn't know, that is searching for answers, that is afraid of the future. But now, because I'm connected to Jesus, because of the price that was paid for me, that I can be assured that my future is bright, that I've got answers, that Jesus is a solution to everything in my life. And it starts by accepting him. You see, you can't get to Jesus your way. You can't unshackle your bondage and your DNA and your predisposition to sin because you read a book, because you studied meditation, because you read philosophy. You cannot get disconnected from your predisposition that way. The only way you and I can become followers and disciples and free from God, free from our sin and nature, is by Jesus Christ. Why? Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one, he says, no one goes to the Father except through him. So today I want to give you the opportunity to accept that gift. You see, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way in. He's not going to make his way in. Listen, he's not going to kick down the door of your heart and kick and make his way in. Jesus says these words. He says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And he whoever opens the door, I will come in and I will dine with him and he will dine with me. We will abide together. It comes by you making the decision today to choose, like Paul the Apostle said, to choose to surrender yourself to Jesus Christ, the answer to the questions of your life. The answer to the issues you face. The answer to the emptiness you have been living with. Jesus. John, the 3rd chapter, Jesus is speaking to a religious man. He says, you must be born again. What does born again mean? It's not what society, what internet culture, or what the TV has made it out to be. Born again from the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word has always meant the same thing. You ready for it? Here it is. That you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life through Jesus Christ. It's all or nothing relationship. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus says to his church, he says, listen, I'm coming back. He says, I'd rather find that you're hot. I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, what is lukewarm? It's neither hot nor cold. It's neither here nor there. It's stagnant and nothing. And he says, if I find you in that position, you don't even understand where you are. He says, I will vomit you from my mouth. But that doesn't have to be the solution. That doesn't have to be the end game. Why? Because Jesus died for a greater purpose than for you and I to sit in an auditorium and give ourselves a title. Jesus died for a greater purpose than for you and I to assume or to live and to hope that we are no longer connected to that sin nature or that predisposition. Jesus died so that we could be connected to him and we could leave that behind and we could live a life bound for glory. But it starts by accepting Jesus. Today, I want to give you the opportunity. Jesus says these words, and in the Bible, he says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. But he says, if you deny me, he says, I'll deny you. Today, I want to give you that option. I want to give you that decision. Here's what I'm going to do. On the count of three, I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm just going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I'm making a decision today. Pastor Luke, what you're talking, man, it hit me right where I'm at. You're speaking to me. I feel like there's a call right now. I feel like there's something drawing me. And the Bible says that no one can come to the Father unless he's been drawn. The Spirit of God is drawing you right now. It's the goodness of God speaking to you. You say, man, I got to respond to that. I got to make a decision. I'm going to follow Jesus with my life. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge you. You can put it right back down. Say, if I raise my hand, I think I might be embarrassed. People I came with are going to know a little bit about me. Listen, let me tell you something. If somebody invited you here today, this is exactly why they invited you. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. It's a divine appointment right now between you and God. Don't let anything stop you from making the very best and wisest decision you can make with your eternal life right here, right now, by choosing to accept life through Jesus Christ. Who should raise their hands if you've never given him your heart, you've never given him your life? If that's you in just a moment, get ready. Pop your hand up. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group. Maybe you went to a crusade and you prayed that prayer. You prayed a prayer once before with a TV minister, but you've never really followed through. You feel like I'm still stuck here. It's time for you to make the decision to release the bondages of sin and get yourself connected with life and with freedom and liberty and purpose and fulfillment with Jesus Christ. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, if you've been playing the church game, listen, you know what that means. Doing the church thing on Sunday, playing the part, talking to everybody who's a Christian like you're a Christian, but then when you're in your private life, you're doing your own thing. I love you enough, I respect you enough today to tell you the truth, you're not going to make it. But that doesn't have to be your end game. Why? Because God wants more for you. Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Today, the decision is yours, the choice is yours, the opportunity is yours today to accept and to choose life with your life. I want to give you that opportunity. So I'm going to count to three in just a moment, wherever you're at, from side to side, front to back. Even you guys in the family rooms, I can see you through the windows. Maybe you're outside watching on the television through the closed circuit system, or you're at home on the live stream watching right now. You can minimize it. Click the little blue button that says, no God, and somebody will lead you in a prayer. The decision is totally yours right here, right now. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. When I count to three, if that's you, be brave and be bold and be proud about it. You're making the very best decision you can to pop your hand up. I won't embarrass you. But even if you were, it'd be better to spend a moment of embarrassment than an eternity in hell. Because you can go forward for God. But the decision starts with you. So I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. And we'll go forward together from there. You and I will change destinies together tonight. So you guys ready? I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. Today is the day of your salvation. No, don't wait another minute. This is your moment. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in the house today. Where are you at in this place? One, two, three. I see you guys right over there. Three wise people. Four, five. I got you guys right over there. Four, five wise people. Anybody else in this place? Six. I got you over there in the back. Seven. I got you guys. Seven wise people. Anybody else? You say, man, I wonder if I should. Did you already raise your hand, my man? Okay, I got you guys. I got you guys. Seven wise people. Anybody else in this place? You say, man, I wonder if I should. This is your moment. You guys in the family rooms, if that's you, give me a little wave. I don't want to miss you. Seven wise people. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Yep, you should. This is your moment. This is your time. Anybody else? Anybody else today? Well, let's give God a great big praise for seven wise people. Amen. Hallelujah. Here's what we're going to do. All seven of you, maybe you're number eight, maybe you're number nine, maybe you're number 10. You didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have. You said, dang it, that was me. I missed my opportunity. No. You didn't make that decision, but you can follow through with it right now. You see, if that was me today, we're going to do this together. We're going to follow through. I said, you're making a decision. You know this. Every decision requires action, and I want to do it with you today. We're going to act on it together right here, right now. So if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need, a friend if you came with somebody, or somebody brought you. Listen, I want you to look at them and say, come on, I'll go with you. Get out of your seat, get out of your chair. We're all going to stand in just a moment. And as we do, I want you to get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here at this altar. I want to shake your hand, and I want to change destinies with you right here, right now. So let's all stand together. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, come on, this is your moment. This is your time. Today is the day of your salvation. Come on, you come. You come wherever you're at. This is your moment.
And I want to know you.
you come. Praise God. Shake your hand. Great job, guys. Awesome. Congratulations. Wonderful. Congratulations. Good job. Praise God. Six. Okay. Number seven. Come on. Listen, I love you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to get saved because you raised your hand in a church service. That's great. That's wonderful. That's religion. And religion didn't save anybody. Jesus did. And I don't want you to get wrapped up in religion. Get wrapped up in Jesus, because that's what's going to make the change. So I'll ask Elijah to sing that one more time. Elijah, when he sings that, if you should have raised your hand and you didn't, or you did raise your hand but you're not here, come on. I want you to be bold. I want you to accept that gift that God is giving to you, eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. And come on up here and let's make that decision together. Go for it, Elijah. One more time.
And I surrender. And I
surrender. You can come. This is your moment. This is your time.
And I want to know you more. I want to know you more. I surrender.
All right, bud. Hey, you guys came.
Yeah.
And somebody needs to tell you, good job. Good job. You know, maybe nobody's ever told you in your life, good job. Maybe you've been like me and you make a lot of bad choices, but today, making the very best decision you possibly can. Heaven's having a party for you right now. That's pretty cool. Somebody's partying for you right now. They're rejoicing. They're celebrating. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here? His name is Sin Nature. No, I'm just kidding. His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really cool guy, okay? Here's what he's going to do. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Nothing weird goes on, all right? Listen, I'm as weird as it gets. I got handcuffs on a stage in a church. That's a little scary. All right, you made it through me. He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved because you raise your hand. You get saved because you're inviting Jesus into your heart. You're going to do that in prayer, okay? Second thing he's going to do is we want to leave you hooked up, okay? We don't want you to leave this place empty-handed. We want to get some information in your hands. We got a simple, real easy-to-read little book. Take you about 25, 30 minutes to read through it to help point you in the right direction because you're on this new journey with all of us together, and we're going to help set you off on the right foot. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back. Hang out with us, okay? We got friends. We want to give away friends. We got spiritual personal trainers. You know, go to the gym, you get a personal trainer, so that way you don't look like a dummy on that equipment that you have no clue how to use. Somebody will teach you how to do it. We got spiritual personal trainers, a friend, somebody that will meet with you right here at church to buy you a cup of coffee or a soda in our cafe, sit down with you for a couple of weeks to teach you some things about the Word of God to get you strong, so that you don't go back to that predisposition, but you go forward with Jesus because you're following after him. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my buddy, Pastor Joel. Congratulations, guys. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.